Hi, today I will introduce you to Godot. So it's a very beginner-friendly tutorial, and you will use the textual code and not the graph code. Why? Because the textual code ends up being easier. But let's get started and launch Godot. You will see that I have already quite a few projects, but we just create a new one. So for that, we click on the new project button and I will create it on the desktop. So you don't have to go to the desktop, but it's easier for to show you if everything is in the desktop. Okay, I will so select the desktop, and now I can name the project. And I will name it Coach Tank. Okay, it's created the folder on the desktop and we are ready to create. We see already that we have to make another choice is OpenGL, and the newer version is faster, has more possibilities, but doesn't work necessarily on the web. The other one is maybe slower, but works on the web. So. But for what you are doing, we'll keep the default one. So now we are presented with this view. This is a 3D view, but we'll quickly switch to the 2D view and we'll do a town games. Kids Can Code did a tutorial on tanks, but it's more advanced, and this tutorial will be very step by step and very beginner friendly. So once you complete this one, you can go to his channel and follow the tutorial, and you will recognize some step, but he will go a bit faster and he will show you other stuff too. So it's a good continuation. Okay. So what we have there is an interface with panes, and you have the scenes pane where we will create the scene. And what is a scene in Godot is a tree of nodes, and that means that we will have nodes with children behind them. And this is important because in Godot everything is a scene and is composed of a scene. So it's a bit abstract, and to make it more concrete, we'll start to do the game. The first thing I have to do is import the sprite. So you can see that I have a folder with nice images. And in Godot, it's very easy to import the sprite. Just drag and drop the sprite in the file system in Godot. But we want a bit of organization, so we'll create a new folder in Godot that I call sprite. I select it and now I just drag and drop this sprite in the file system, and you could see the small dialog that was showing the progress of import. So now we have our nice sprites that are there. Sometimes you need to change properties of this sprite, and in Godot it's possible by clicking the sprite and going into import, and then you have many options. We will not cover them because it's a bit more advanced, so we don't need that for the basics. So let's go back to the scene itself. To build the tank, we will need to add a node, and our tank will be something that has to move, and for that we have to choose a kinematic node, and the option is not available there, so we will click other nodes. And by doing that, I have this dialog where I can search something, and as I said, it's kinematic because it has some movement. Now there is something interesting. You see that we have two choices. One is a pink reddish and it says kinematic body, and the other is bluish and says kinematic body 2D, and these nodes are color coded, so every 2D node will be bluish and every spatial node will be pinkish reddish. So we know that we have to pick that one because we will do a game in two dimensions. So now the window did switch automatically because the engine knows that we want to work with 2D. And you can see that we have a small cross on the top left of the screen. This cross is the origin of our kinematic body, and it's at 0, 0. We can also use an inspector on the right, and I will expand the transform subtree. And you can see that we have the X and Y position. So every node has a X and Y position that is relative to its parents. Here it's the root nodes of our scene, so it's the same as the global position for now. If I click and hold my mouse and drag, I can change the value. It's a bit slow, we can go faster. I can click, hold, drag, and then press Ctrl key, the Ctrl key on the keyboard, hold it, and now if I do the same, so just dragging left and right, you can see that it increments by 1 pixel, so it's a bit faster. Yeah, so that's the idea. Okay, and we can do the same with the Y coordinate. And now we did figure out something, is that the Y axis is going downward. That's very important to take note of that. And if you don't know what X and Y means, it's like how many steps horizontally than vertically you have to do to reach any point on the screen. For example, if I do this, that means I need to do 30 steps on the right. And if I do like this, it means that I need to do 14 steps downward. And it makes this point unique. And we can say that this point is 33x and 40y. So that's a way to identify each point on the screen. This is quite important because it will be used for everything, basically. Since we are dealing with moving stuff. So just remember that. Now you can see that we have a exclamation mark, and this is Godot trying to help us. And if you click on it, you have this message, and it says, okay, you need to have a shape, and it says add this or that. So we will follow the advice and use a simple collision shape for now. So I can right click on the node and add child node. Here I can filter by typing collision, and I will take the collision shape. Note that on the left, we have the list of recent nodes we used. So the more we will go in depth in the game, the more this list will be filled. So that's good because it's our quick access list, and so we don't have to filter this. I will create the collision shape, and again, I have this small exclamation marks, but I will let it for now. What I am interested in, so I'm grabbing the screen by holding the middle mouse button, and I can drag around. So now what I'm interested in is adding a sprite, the base sprite. So I can drag and drop the sprites from the file explorer, and if I let it go, it will drop a sprite. And you can see that the sprite is the child of my collision shape. I don't really want that, so I will click and drag the node and drop it just below the kinematic body. You can see that there is a line that shows where it will land. Now the sprite should be also centered on the origin of my scene. And for that, I can go to the transform panel and click this curly arrow. and this did reset to 0, 0. So now it's correctly sent out. Now that I have that sprite, I can define my collision shape to match it. So I click on the nose, it's what I did to select it. And on the right, you can see that there is a shape property with empty, and there is a small caret, a small arrow. That means that if I click it, it will show some kind of menu. Here, this menu is showing all the shapes I can create. And here we want, obviously, a rectangle. Now I have my red rectangle and I have this small red dot. So I can scroll with the mouse to make the rectangle bigger, and I can use the dots and drag them to define the size. Alors, a mistake would be to do like this, bleeding, or to be very precise like this. What you want to do is being a bit smaller than your sprite, because when you have collision, if you are too precise, then the sprite may jump and you will see that there is a gap between the object you are colliding with and your sprite itself. But if the two sprites overlaps a bit, people don't notice it, so it's better to have that way. So we will do like that. And you can also, if you expand, you can also use numerical value. For example, here it's not totally the same, so I will type 78 78, because this is a square. We can also rename the node, and for that we just select the node and then click once. So you select once and then you click and you can rename it, and we'll say tank because it's a tank. To save the scene, because you see the tabs is not saved and it's indicated by an asterisk, you can do Control S. Or go to the menu and do save scene. Because I did name the root node tank, it already gave me a correct scene name. So I can just hit enter, and in the file system, you can see that the tank.tscn, so the scene, is correctly saved. Now we will need to add the turret to that tank, and for that, we just take the cannon. I will just duplicate this, and to duplicate a node, you can do Ctrl D. Ctrl D, duplicate a node. I will rename this as turret, and I will change the texture. To change the texture, I can do click on it, and then open the correct path with that, or there is a simpler way. I can take the cannon texture, and if you look closely, there is a blue border around the texture, and that means I can drop my sprite over it, because that's a slot that accepts the resource that I was dragging. Okay, so now we want to rotate the cannon around the base of it. So we need to change the pivot point. For that, there is an offset property and it says 0, 0. We want to shift the cannon on the right, so we will increase X. So remember, Alt Control and it goes faster. Like this. Another thing that is important is that the order of node is relevant. So if I take this turret and I put it at the top, you will see that it's now hidden behind the body or the base. So I will just put it in the correct order. Turret, then base. So, which is not the correct, base, turret. And so now the turret is on top as we need. You will also see that now we have this blue rectangle square. This will not be shown in game, so that's okay. and we can preview this little tank. Now we have a small issue. It's on the top left and it's cut, but that's normal because we are just editing the tank. To be able to place the tank wherever we want, we will create the main game. So I will hit this plus near the tab and it will create a new scene. Now to set up that scene, we need a bit more nodes, and what you should do is add a white node. This white node is not specialized in any way, it's some node, and it can hold spatial and 2D and control node. So let's just pick that, and now we will add a node 2D. That will be the playing field. I'm renaming this main, hitting Ctrl S, and it says mains.tscn, which is the name I want, so I hit enter. To add the tank as a child of my node 2D, I select the node 2D and then I go grab the tank.scn. And as you can see, I can drag and drop it around. So I'll put it on the view. Now my tank is there. I can have many of them. I can just select again the node on which I want to put tanks and drag and drop the tank. So now I have two tanks. If we run that, we see that we have two tanks. Okay, let's delete tank number two. So I select it and I press delete on the keyboard. It asks confirmation, I hit enter, and the node is gone. Control S to save. The first thing we want to do is to have this turret rotate toward the mouse cursor. For that, you will need a script. So there is, instead of switching tabs or having to find the tank, let's say this tab is closed, I can use the shortcut here. It's the small clapper, and if I click on that, it will open the scene automatically. So that's handy when you have many objects. Now I want to add some behavior to that, so mainly having the turret rotate, and for that we select the node to which we want to add the code or the behavior, and we click on the small scroll. Now we have some choice, and we can choose other language like a DLL, the GDScript, what we will use, or the Visual Script. The Visual Script is very cumbersome to use, not very friendly, and GDScript is way easier in the end. So let's keep that. You see that it detects that it's kinematic body 2D, so generally you don't have to change this. The template, you have either default, empty, and no comment. So these are the kind of template you want to start with. And the default is beginner friendly, so I will let that. But that means that we will have to remove some comments. We never want to check that. I don't know why there is this option, but it's better to have separate scripts because that way they are reusable. If you check this, the script will be directly in your scene and not reusable. So let's keep that one. Now we have the script with some commands coming from the template. And I will just remove them. So everything with a pound is a command. Another thing to notice is that the function that is already there begins with an underscore. Everything with an underscore should be reserved for the engine. So never write a function yourself and begin with underscore. That's very bad. Because in the future, they may want to add a same function, and then you will wonder what is happening with your game and why it breaks. So never start a name with an underscore. Let it for the engine. This is a special function, and we can see what it does by holding control. And now you see that when I pass my mouse over words, they are underlined. So if I click on ready, it will open the documentation. So that's in a bit built-in documentation, and basically this one explains that this is called when the node has its ID and has all its children ready too. So that's what we want to use. Basically, if we want to change the turret or something like that, we need to store it in a variable. So that's why I type var and call getNode. The getNode functions get a node, and as you can see in the autocompletion, so it provides me with dot. Dot is the current node, so the tank. Base is the base, turret the turret, and collision shape, yeah. So that match, and it's like a directory. So it's a path to the node. So we are interested by the turret. Now, if I do that, the thing is that I want to use the turret at every step and not only when I am ready. So I need a way to have this variable available to every function. And that's quite easy because we can take this code and put it there. But yeah, that's a bit misleading because we have to get the node and save it only when the code is ready, when the node is ready. And at the bottom you can see that Godot says what I have to do. The onReady means, yeah, when it's ready, then do the assignment. And lastly, getNode is a bit long to type, so I just typed it once to show you what is the method. But there is a shortcut. Let's remove this and we can do dollar and turret. That's the same code, it's just shorter to type, so usually you want to use the dollar shortcut. And it's also quite unique, so there is no way to confuse it with something else. Okay, so now we have a pointer to our turret and we can make it do something. So let's do very simple stuff to begin with. So you can see that we have some variable, some value that is called delta that is passed to our function. And this value is the time between two frames in our game, because the engine will try to call process as much as possible. And if you do something crazy, like let's do for the experience, I will rotate the turret by 1 degree. Okay, so each time the engine called this code, I rotate the turret by 1 degree. And this toe is like one full circle. So if I divide one full circle by 360, I have 1 degree. So it's that's nice that there's this constant. You can see that as one circle. So one rotation. Okay, let's go to the main tab, and now I can play the scene by clicking on the small clapper here. And you can see that, yeah, it's not smooth because sometimes it shakes a bit. And this happens because my computer has not a constant speed. It can go faster than slower. And that's why it does that. Now we will fix that by using the delta. So if I multiply that, because this is the time elapsed between two frames in seconds, that means that it will take 1 second to make the full rotation. And now you can see that it's nicer. It doesn't depend anymore to the speed of my computer. It's a bit fast. So what I will do is like say that it does only one quarter turn per second. And yeah, it's better. And yeah, and also now I have I know that it will take 1 second to make one quarter turn. So if I do this, it will make 1/10 of a turn in 1 second. So it's even also easier to know how much time it will take to do something. So that's good to use the delta for many reasons, but the main reason is that the speed of your computer changes over time, so this function will be called more or less. And so you want to catch up if it wasn't called enough, or you want to be smoother if it's called much more. So yeah, that's a way to make everything smooth. Now we want to target the mouse, and for that we need to change the rotation of our cannon. So let's try something. Curette dot global rotation. And why I use the global rotation? That's because each node is rotated in relatively to the parent. So if the parent is rotated 30 degrees clockwise and the child is rotated 45 degrees counterclockwise, it's like for the world, like if the child is rotated counterclockwise 15 degrees. So so now let's write global rotation equal turret that position, and so get global mouse position that angle. So by doing that, normally the turret will follow the mouse, and that's not really the case. Why? Because I didn't use the global position. Okay, so now we see that I can move the turret with the mouse. And why is it working? That's a good question. So what happens is that we are using vectors. So this is a position, this is another position, and both of these are vector. And what is a vector? Let's just do a quick break and see what it is. And for that, I will just skip to the project list. And I have something about vector. Okay, so I have lost my it's math. Okay, so this is the project where I can explain a bit about the vectors. So basically, a vector is an arrow. Voilà, just have to set up it properly. So here we can see that we have a blue and a red vector, and I can move the tip of the vector. And this is like a displacement, so a move. How to go from a point to relatively this position. And here I added a green and like magenta one that you can see. And these are special vectors. Basically, the green arrow you can see that is the addition of the two vectors, the blue and the red one. So if we want to go that direction, we can go on the right, the red vector, and then upward, the blue vector. And making these two steps is the same as making the green one. And we can move them around, and you can see that it's always like, if I do that, I can do the red and then the blue one like this, and I would end up always at the tip of the green one. So that's a simple addition, but it's already powerful. Now the this one, the move one, is more special because it tells us what is the shadow of the red one over the blue one. So here, if the red one is leaning in the same direction of the blue one, you see that the red one casts a shadow on it. If I do that, you can see that the shadow is not anymore on the blue vector, it's on the opposite direction. So that way it's the same direction, and that way it goes in the other direction. And it happens that the direction flips when the two vectors are perpendicular, so when they have a 90 degree angle. And that means that by finding this vector, we can know if something is on the same direction than something else. So let's say that the blue vector is an enemy, then it's looking at the forward, and everything that is in this range that I am showing with the red vector would be seen by the enemy, and everything that is past this angle would be hidden. It would be in the back of the enemy. So by knowing a bit your vectors, you can do nice trick. But another nice thing is the angle stuff that we saw. So the vectors are also a position encoded. The position are encoded as vector, and I created a vector between the tank center and the mouse. So by doing the mouse position minus the tank center, I created a vector like the blue one. And because I explained how to go from the tanks to the mouse, and I got this vector. And then there is a method that gives us the angle that is there between blue and red. And that way I can orient the turret properly. So the concept of vector is very useful. Let's go back to the tank. Just reopening the main scene. Okay, so we have our tanks, and now the tank can target the mouse. The next step is to spawn a bullet, so we will create a new scene with only the bullet. So I will use the plus button, and it will be a rigid body, because I will not control it directly. I will let the physics engine take over it. Okay, same as before, we have the exclamation mark, but now we know what it means. But we'll need to make a more precise shape, so it will be a bit different than what we did. So the first thing I will do, right click a child node, I will use a sprite. And that sprite will be the bullet. So I'm drag and drop pick on the texture. Now I have my bullet. And that's fine, that it's there. I don't have to change the offset. But now I can draw the shape. And how I will do that? I will right click on the rigid body at child node and type collision and select collision polygon. Now I have to draw the shape, and for that I will just zoom on the, so with the scroll wheel on the bullet, click on the create point and click where I want to create the points, and I am just going around the graphic, and that's it, I have my region, my polygon. Let's rename the rigid body to bullet and Ctrl S to save. Enter, and we have our new scene. What I want to do is that when the bullet is spawned, when you create the bullet, I want the bullet to shoot and to go forward. Or no, I will just say I will let it that way. And we'll have the tank shoot it. So let's go back to the tank and add our bullet shooting capabilities. For that, I will need some key to shoot the bullet, and I will pick the left mouse button, and we have to configure that. We can go to the project menu, project settings, and there is a input map tab. And in the action, we can type shoot and then click on the add button. There is a new line that is called shoot, and there is a plus. So we can click on the plus and say mouse button. Which button? Button, the left. Okay. And we can close it. I will save again. Ctrl S and edit the script. So now we want to shoot a bullet each time we click the left button. So it will be if input and is action, because these are action, just pressed, because I want to do it only once and not while you are pressing down. So only at the moment you press down, I want to shoot my bullet. So, okay, I will type pass. Pass is something that does nothing, but that is a valid syntax to put an empty block. So, my if now has an empty block that does nothing. So, that's correct code. And I need to say how to create a bullet. For that, I have to explain to Godot that I want to unpack a scene. And for that, we'll just do var bullet pack equal and call the preload function. And the preload function takes a scene and parameter. So now I'm preloading the bullet as a packed scene, so as a template. And the bullet pack will be able to create an object from my template. So I can do bullet pack dot instance, and this one will create a bullet. But this bullet is created somewhere in memory in the computer, but it's not attached to the game in any way. So yeah, no, it will not appear or anything like that. To make it appear, I have to attach it to the tree, and to attach a node to a tree, we can do get tree dot root, so we get the root node dot add child. So now we have our child that can be added, that is added, sorry. And we also need to give him a position. And the easiest way to have the position, the bullet spawn where you want to spawn it, is to add a position. So I will just add a spawning point. So I right click on the turret, add child node, position, and I will just change the position of this. And now when I start to drag and drop, and then I hold the control, and that means that it snaps to the axis, so it's easier. So I just put this spawning point where it looks good. Yeah, it's not correct. I would put a bit further things. Okay, and I can show you that this position 2D is linked to the turret. So I did select the turret, I go to transform, and I have a slider here, and I can rotate the turret. And you can see that the child is also rotated, because the position and rotation of the child is relative to the parent. The same way, if I move the tank itself, or if I rotate the tank, everything is rotated. And if I translate the tank, everything is translated. That's a very important concept. Okay. So now I have my spawn point. Let's rename it as bullet spawn point position. Okay. And from the code, we will just grab this position and fire the bullet. On ready, because we need that every child node is already added before grabbing them. Spawn point $, and you can see that now we have a full path with a slash turret, that's a slash bullet spawn position. So it's really like the file system or something like that. Okay. Or a URL, like when you visit websites. Okay, I add the child, the bullet, and now I need to, because if I do that, the bullet will spawn at 0, 0. And we can try this. I could do is, you see that the same thing is flashing on the top left, and it's more visible on the main, obviously. So let's take the main, and up we have a bullet, and there is something happening too. The bullet is falling. Why? Because we are simulating a 2D physics, so there is a default gravity. The first thing is also to remove that gravity. For that we go to project settings, general, and you have this button, you can click it, and now we have a search box. And we type gravity. Now we have for 2D and 3D, but we are doing 2D. And here the 98 becomes 0. And you can see that default gravity vector is 0, 1. That means 1 down, because the y direction is going downward. So let's close this. Save. And now if I launch the game again and click, the bullet just stay in place. If I click again, the other bullet is just pushing the previous bullet. So we can do quite a mess, but that's not what we want to do. Nice, the nice add. I will blur that. So now we have the bullet and we want some action. For that, we have to give an impulse, but also we have to spawn it at the right place. So let's do the first things. And you see that I use global underscore position and not position, because I want to, I don't want to compute position within the parent, etc. So I use a shortcut that is provided by Godot. Bullet dot position equal spawner dot position. Spawn point, I have it. And maybe I should be consistent in my naming too. So try to use the snake case. So if I launch that, we will see that the bullet will spawn at the muzzle. Yeah, but there is something odd with the bullet. It spawns always horizontally, and that's normal. We didn't set any rotation, so we have to do give the same rotation. And some stuff, I will use the global rotation, and it's equal to turret.globalRotation. And now we have the bullet spawning at the right rotation, but yeah, there is not much motion. Also, you see that there is some space, and yeah. Depends if you want to add some effect, but we can limit this space. And nicely, we have this nice spawner that we can move back. So we can easily say like, 180 maybe? Yeah, maybe. And just try it again. Yeah, it's closer, and we could add some effect, but okay. So now we have the bullet spawning, but no action. So I will click on the scroll to go back to the script, and we'll give some impulse. And for that, I said it. We apply a central impulse. And how we want to apply this impulse? We want to apply it by doing a vector 2, and that is going on the right, and that is rotated at the same so like the bullet. And if you do that, it's 1 pixel per second, so we want maybe something like 64 pixels per second. And yeah, that's maybe not what we want, so we'll just say 256. Okay, that's a bit slow, huh? So then you have to toy a bit with the values. Voila, this is a bit more convincing. So now we have a tank that can shoot, so that's nice. Now let's see how to move the tank. And to move the tank, we need also to have some caterpillar, and I have already the sprite for that, so that's nice too. And let's create the caterpillar itself. And I'm wondering if I should do a scene for that. I will just do there. So, subwrapped a child node, and it will be an animated sprite. And see that it's not a sprite, it's animated sprite, so it's another kind of node. And this node can have multiple animations, and also multiple sprites in the same animation. So let's click on frames and same stuff. We have the small carrot. That means if we click, we have a menu, new sprite, and nothing happens. Why? Because we have to expand this again to see the panel that contains the animation. Okay, I will just drag and drop. So I click the first shift and the last, and it selects everything in between. And now I can click, hold, and drag and drop. And I have my caterpillar. We can also enable the playing, and we see that it plays, and change the speed. So I have speed scale, I can put 4, and yeah, that's a bit faster. Now I have to put the position correctly. Like I will put 80 then. Okay, and I will name this caterpillar. That I will say caterpillar, and it's the right one. I can duplicate it and say this one will be the left, and I will transform minus 80. And lastly, we want this to be under the base. That's more convincing. So if we go to the main and launch this, we have the moving caterpillar with a static tank. Okay, so now we can close this and we'll make it move. Again, we need some keys to make it moving, so we'll go to project setting, and input map. Let's put a forward add, and it will be, I am using an AZERTY keyboard, so it's not WASD, but it will be T for forward. Then the Z key, and then let's turn right. It will be the D key, and the turn left will be the Q key. And now we have the basic inputs. We still need to explain Godot how to handle the input, so I will click the scroll near the tank and I will complete this code. And now I will not use the just, but I will use the action pressed, because while I'm holding down the key down, I want it to turn, so it's a continuous process. And we'll say that it's an half turn per second. I do Control C, Control V, and I will just put left here and do a minus. Let's already try this, because I may have swapped the rotation, and now it's correct. Okay. Now we need to go forward, and that's the nice stuff where we will need to understand a bit vectors. So basically, the tank has some basic transform. So if I do transform.basis, basis xform, that says how to transform some vector if I have a vector, how I have to transform it to match the new vector. So if I do vector do dot right, how this one looks like for my tank. So because my tank is rotated, and so the white is not anymore on the white. If it's rotated, it can be down. And the basis X form will transform this right to the local right of the tanks. So if I do that, then I can just do the move, and I will do a move on slide, so the tank, and I will do a move on collide, so that will stop the tank, and I want to move that way, and I have to give a speed. The speed will be like 60 pixels per second again, and we can keep everything else like it is. Let's try this. And it jumps. Why? Because it says just pressed. And I want pressed like I did above. So I will just copy paste this there. And yeah, it's too fast because this one probably need the delta to be applied. So I will put dot delta. Yeah. So now I have this, and if I turn it, you can see that the tank is turning properly. So that's a way to do this. And the idea is that, so I have a vector that says to the right, and I say, yeah, but what is this vector for the point of view of the tank, what it is? So as if the tank wasn't rotated, yeah, so it simply asks the right from the point of view of the tank. And so now we have the tanks which can shoot and travel. Now we need some target. So let's add a new scene. And you can see that I'm just adding scene and scene and scenes. And yeah, that's just that easy, in fact. Okay, other node. And I will put a static body this time. So this one are body that do not move. And so they are not sensitive to forces, they are just static, like for scenario and stuff like that, or targets. So I will name it target, and we'll add some sprite for that. So right click at child node, I can click sprite here, and I can drag and drop the texture, and now I have my target. I need to define a shape, which is quite easy for a target. We can recycle the collision shape 2D, because that one, if we go to the shape with the card stuff, we can choose a circle. Same as before, we have a red dot, if I zoom, and we can use, I will use the pointer, we can use the red dot to make the circle. So for the target, I will make it a bit bigger because it's more fair for the user. And I did Control S and it names it appropriately, and I can save. So now we have our target and it does nothing else. What we have to say is that we want to handle the collision. And yeah, it will be on the tank. So we have on the bullet. So we have the bullet, and we have contact monitor. This will permit the engine to report collision. So we have to enable it, and we have to put at least one reporting. So we know at least one stuff that did collide, and that's all we need to know. We have also to say what happens when the bullet collides with the target. So what I will do is add a script to the bullet, and the name is derived from the node, so it's okay. And now I need to connect some event. And we want to know when a body is entered. We want to connect the event to this object. And here we have the list of methods. And I will just say collision. Or maybe on collision. I create the same method, Ctrl C, Ctrl V, And this requires some parameters. So I can click on rigid body, so control and click on rigid body 2D, and I will see the signals. So I have body entered and body node. Yeah, okay. That seems what I want. So I just need one parameter. So I can go back to the bullet script and say body. So that's the body that did collide. And I need to check that this body is the target. And how I can check that? I will not, in fact. I will do something else, because that's bad practice also to know everything about everything everywhere. But what we can do is if the body has method, so if I can call a function, a specific function, like it, then I will just say it. So now I'm just saying if the body is able to be it, then it is. Okay. And that means that on the target, I have to add a script, and it says automatically target.gd because we did name it properly. And here I can just add it. And in that function, I decide what I want to do with the target when it's it. And what I want to do is make it disappear. So I destroy the target. And now the bullet will collide with something that can be a wall. And if it's a wall, the bullet will be destroyed and nothing happens. But if it's a target, or if it's something with a hit ability, then it will be hit, and then only after the bullet will be destroyed. So if we test that, then nothing spectacular happens because I didn't add the target yet. So let's add the target. And don't be confused and start adding sprites by drag and dropping sprites. You have to drag and drop the target.tscn. So let's put it there, so it's easier to target, and launch it. Boom, it disappears. So that's the idea. And now we can maybe go fancier and put another target. Also, we didn't, the tank is not that fast. We didn't handle the collision for the tank itself. So the, because the target is static, the tank is simply blocked by it. Voilà, so you see that when I rotate, it patches the tanks. But if I shoot a bullet, then the targets disappear when it's hit. Okay. Another stuff that is overlooked is that the bullet I did shoot, so if I launch the game and I do like this, all these bullets exist forever. So we can see that by doing a debug mode. So, so I will just relaunch it again, and now on the inspector on the scene, you see we have local and remote. If I click remote, then we see that we have our root node. And if I shoot a bullet, it appears. And if I shoot a bullet that would disappear, you don't even have the time to see it appear. But if I do that, I'm just creating plenty of bullets, and if I play the game for 1 hour, my computer will just break, because slow down and stuff like that, because there will be too many objects on the scenario. So we have to clean up this, and we will do it, because that's a good exercise too. And for that, I will just right click, add child node, and we have a visibility notifier and visibility enabler. We'll take the visibility notifier, and this one has some So I can also click on the notes right of the inspector, and I see also the nice list of signals. Then it says viewport excited or screen excited. So we'll take this one. Yeah, maybe the end. Visibility notifier and vn.connect, so it's the signal, and here we say screen excited, and you can see that Godot is really smart because it shows me the signals. And I just put on screen excite, and so destroy it. And now if I go back to the main scene, launch it, click remote, so we can see the, okay, I didn't intend to do that up, and click to see the game and shoot one bullet. Now there is, you can see that occasionally, let's go to the as far as I can. You can see that the bullet is created and then destroyed. And that way, we have only a limited amount of objects. I mean, I'm clicking like crazy and I can't have that many bullets. So that's something you have to think about. Otherwise, the game will go to a crawl and then you will say that Godot sucks because it's slow. So yeah, you have to think about what you are doing too, but that's not like it's difficult. Okay, so we have our bullet, our target, and we need some walls because it's not nice to be able to get everywhere. Maybe you want to have some kind of maze, and for that we'll create a tile set. So the first thing is to add a child node. And we'll say tile, and you have the tile map. The tile map will be what will host the tiles. Okay, and same stuff, we have tile sets, arrow kind of stuff. So if we click, we can create a resource and we want a new tile set. And same as with the animation, we have to click it to open. And now we have the pane that open, and we can add images. So here it's very simple, we just have a wall, so I'm drag and dropping the wall tile set, and it's a new single tile because there is only one tile. And we also want to configure it properly, and to have information about the sprite I can double click it, and I see 100 by 100. So if I go back to the tile map and click on the tile set and drag and drop this again, because I didn't save, I know that this is 100 by 100, so in the resource, the single tile, and now this I want to set up to be 100, so, and so that should be there. Ah, voilà. Don't know why, but okay. And I will say 100 by, so I had to draw the square by 100. And I will just redraw the square, and now I cover the full tile. So that's done. That's all we have to do. So I hit Ctrl S to save my tile set. And I can click on the tile map. The tile map is not yet set up properly either. So I have to go to the cell and say no, it's 100 by 100. This is for some optimization, but I have this here, it's not useful. And that's all there is. I don't know. We have also to add the collisions, so that's not all there is. So let's go back to the wall and click this one and click on collision. and you can choose if you want a rectangle or a polygon. So I will just do that and click on the tile. I just did a single click and it does cover the whole tile. That's what I want. Now I can say that it's done. So it's all there is. And we can start drawing our game. I click on the tile and then draw the sign. Just dragging the mouse. And we have our little level. So let's play this. And you can see that the top is cut and the bottom is cut. And now we have an issue. The issue is that the tank is too slow, and so I have to make it faster. And we will make it that we can configure the speed. Yeah, we just put speed in fact. Speed equals and export var of course, speed equal 64 and it will be an integer, so a number from 64, so we can't go lower than 64 and we can't go faster than 1024. So if I go back into the game, now I have the speed variable, so I can just try my stuff too slow and say okay, let's put 512 and interesting. I have, because when you create a variable like this, like speed, you have to use it. So I replace the 64 by this. So now if I run it, it will go faster. Maybe too fast. But the point is that we can test, and now you see that the bottom of the screen is cut. And yeah. That would be nice if we had something like a camera that would follow the tank. And it's got that, so there is. So I want the camera to follow the tank, and we know that the child node position are relative to their parents. So we only have to do one thing, is to add the camera as a child of the node we want to follow. And here it's a tank, so let's create. And now if I launch the game, it doesn't work. Why? Because you have to activate the camera. So you click the camera and you go to you have to set it current. Voilà, current on. So now that's the active camera for the game. And you see that the view has already been offset. And we can travel around the level. So that's the very basics. And you can also see that the bullet is correctly removed when we hit the walls. So these are the basics of Godot. I hope that it was useful. And now from that you can see the tank tutorial for from Kids Can Code, because it does the same but more evolved, and so that's a good extension of what I did, and it goes a bit faster than I did. So yeah, voilà. So I hope you enjoyed this and can work something from that.